I would like to start today with a story about a farmer down under in Australia that brings together many of the water issues that we have been discussing and introduces another one, water impacts of a changing climate. Arthur is a rice farmer who farms in the basin or the watershed of the Murray River, the country's longest river in southern Australia. The land is arid, flat, and empty, kind of like western Oklahoma. But for many years, he has farmed here alongside other farmers who grow cotton, oranges, almonds, and apples, and miles of grapevines to produce some of the world's best wines. It is the food basket of Australia. The land has very little rainfall, but very good soil. The soil loves growing rice, and the Murray Basin rice farmers grow rice at a yield of 3 times the world average. Now, where do they get the water needed to flood these fields with 4 inches of water? From the Murray River, which until recently stored plenty of water in its upstream dams during wet years and released it during the dry years. As I said, until recently. In 2006 and 2007, the river provided no water for irrigation, the first time in 70 years. For the past 3 years, during a time when he should have been planting, watering, and harvesting 31,000 acres of crops, Arthur only had enough water to irrigate 3% of it. Arthur has seen 8 years of drought, and he's pretty sure this is not just a cycle of wet and dry. The climate is changing, becoming drier, and water scarcity is now becoming the dominant fact of life in the food basket. And to top it all off, the city of Adelaide, about twice as large as Oklahoma City, also relies on Murray River water for its inhabitants. So how do you weigh the water rights of a farmer who can feed 100,000 people on the land he owns to a city where those same 100,000 people need water to drink and to bathe in? The situation is ripe for water envy, and that is what is happening in watersheds such as the Murray River, the Colorado River in California, and the Chattahoochee River that flows from Atlanta down into the oyster beds of the Apalachicola Bay in the Florida Panhandle. Who gets the water first, and who will have to go without? This is an example of a water-stressed region that is now knowing much more stress due to climate change. Climate change begins with higher air and ocean temperatures, what we call global warming, but it gets expressed in changing wind and water patterns. You see, heat and cold and differences in temperature, that is temperature differential, are what drive the wind and rainfall patterns and everything that we have come to know as weather and climate. Rising temperatures are expected to influence the whole hydrological cycle, when rain falls and how much. Areas that are affected only slightly can adapt, but some areas will notice big changes, some for the better and some for the worse. Areas that are expected or have already seen increased droughts are places like Australia, Africa, and the western U.S. Good friends of mine are peanut farmers in North Texas. They may have to completely change occupations as the harvest has been dismal in recent years. It is not just surface water that gets affected by drought, but aquifers too that rely on recharge by rainfall. So the Ogallala Aquifer that supplies water to 1/4 of the irrigated land in the U.S. is falling rapidly due to decreased rainfall. But other areas will receive too much rainfall and result in increased flooding. I'm traveling with students to El Salvador in a few weeks, where we will stay in a community that has seen increased flooding due to a combination of more extreme rainfall events and the improper management of dams upstream of these poor villages. Dams are designed using rainfall records of the past. They have to rely on these. But when rainfall patterns change dramatically, the dam has been improperly designed, either overbuilt or underbuilt. Glaciers and ice caps are a reliable source of water for many large populations of people. They store up large masses of frozen water during the winter, and the spring melt provides abundant fresh water as the glacier or ice slowly melts. When rainfall is lessened, the ice buildup is lessened. Glaciers around the world have been shrinking, and it is predicted that 2/3 of China's glaciers will be gone by the year 2060. Sea level rise, an indirect result of melting glaciers, is often talked about in terms of displacing large populations of people, but it also has a water quality effect. As the sea level rises, more shallow aquifers where people get their drinking water will become brackish and no longer fresh. This group I'm taking to El Salvador will be helping a coastal community there explore new water sources. And one question we will ask is, has the high tide level been rising in the past few decades? This high tide level gives us a starting point for finding fresh water in shallow aquifers for the community. We need to be clear about one thing regarding climate change and effects on weather and climate. A single extreme weather event, such as the recent typhoon in the Philippines, cannot be solely attributed to a hotter planet. This is an incident of weather, a single short-term phenomenon. But over a longer period of time, if these kinds of events increase in number and intensity, then we can reasonably say that this longer-term phenomenon is a result of a changing climate. Weather is the state of the atmosphere over a short period of time, and climate is how the atmosphere behaves over relatively long periods of time. Weather looks at single events, climate looks at trends. And finally, the effects of climate change are likely to be worse in watersheds or basins that are already overstressed by urbanization, overpopulation, and other environmental factors, such as deforestation and poor soil management. People in some parts of the world, including El Salvador, have already begun adapting to climate change by doing the things that they can do, such as restoring forests and shoreline plantings, growing crops that are more climate resilient, and improving soil management by low-till farming and erosion prevention. Let's go back to Arthur once again, the rice farmer in Australia. Is this drought caused from natural climate cycling or from climate change that is made worse by human contributions? From where he stands right now, all he knows is that he has several $1 million worth of farming equipment that is sitting idly by, depreciating, and not making him any money. He can only hope that next year the rain will start to fall again.